Thanks for tuning into our seller interview series. Up today, we've got a lead generation site in the legal services niche, making just over $5,000 per month in net profit. The listing number on this one is 40184. Now, we do these interviews to give potential buyers more information about both the seller and the sites they're looking to purchase. We hope these insights are helpful for you in making a buying decision. We've got the seller, Mike, with us today to go through the site and cover everything from niche selection to traffic and monetization. Thanks for coming on, Mike. Appreciate it.
Hey, Justin.
All right, man. So let's do a quick summary on the site. So it was built in February 2011. The monthly revenue is just over $6,000, about $6,200. We've got expenses of just under $1,000 a month, and that's mostly for paid traffic. And then we've got a net profit of $5,200 and change. Can you tell me a little bit about your background in building or running websites and online businesses? And how did you come up with the idea for the site, and what's your background there?
Sure. So I was based in Singapore when I started my own company. And obviously that was around online marketing. And so I tried a few things. Eventually, just talking with other business owners, it seemed there was a gap in the market for lead generation in Singapore because most businesses didn't really know how to use the internet and, you know, generate their leads. So when I saw that demand, it was after networking at a couple of business events. I met the owner of this immigration firm that we're working with now, sort of mentioned, you know, the potential for generating leads for him online. So we sort of started out as a test project, and it just kind of grown from there since 2011. So it's been running a few years.
So just kind of networking on your end, you know, helped make that introduction for you. So you're able to kind of connect with them and said, hey, I think I might be able to get you some leads. You're in a growth, high-paying industry. Let me see what we can do, see if we can make some money together.
Exactly. And with permanent residency, I mean, as an expat myself in Singapore, I kind of knew how difficult it was as a niche because the government doesn't really publicize any information how to get it. So it's not like a point system like other countries like Australia, for example. In Singapore, they don't really tell you what you need, how to apply. They just kind of make it very, very difficult. So there's a big demand for expats in Singapore that want to know how to get PR because there's a high rejection rate, maybe 70% get rejected, you know. So just from that knowledge alone, I knew that there's a high demand for this niche. And if we're able to market online, we'll definitely get leads for that because it's a very high demand service.
Gotcha. So I'm not going to share the exact URL, but we will say that is regarding, you know, Singapore permanent residency, applying for Singapore permanent residency and that kind of thing. And it is an immigration firm that you're providing the leads to. And that's how the site primarily makes money. You have an agreement with this immigration firm and they pay you on a monthly basis. It was lower at some point last year, the year before, and then they bumped it up to get more leads. Is that right?
Yeah. So, I mean, since we started out small and we've just been growing it and growing it as we've been able to, you know, improve the conversion rate on the website and also find other sources of traffic. So it's kind of grown and grown and grown, you know, since 3 years. And now it's generating about 1,000 leads a month. And that's what the client is pretty much taking from us every month. So we just bill him for those leads.
Is this the only thing that firm does, or do they do other immigration or legal services?
They do a few other things. Like they do company incorporation, kind of typical services you would expect from that kind of space. But this is like 90% of their revenue in terms of what the business actually makes money from, because they've been focused on this for 3 years. It's just grown and grown to the point where they have all their sales team and all their staff working on these type of services with these clients.
Have you tried other potential services that they do offer? Have you done any lead generation in that space, or just mostly focused on this?
That's one of the things I've been actually keen to try, but the clients have just been so busy with PR, it's just kind of grown faster than they can handle. So there's not really been much point now trying additional services with them. There definitely is a market for company incorporation. I would say those type of services are a bit more competitive. So there's a lot of other people doing those type of things, but there's not as many doing permanent residency. So it is a bit more niche, and it means it's not as competitive, which means it's better for us because we can advertise cheaper and get leads for cheaper than other types of services.
Did you have any experience in this niche beforehand? I mean, are you at all familiar with kind of the application process or applying for permanent residency, or was it just kind of an opportunity thing?
Well, actually, I had applied for PR myself as an expat, and I got rejected some time ago before I started my company. So I kind of had a very, very rough idea, but I didn't know anything about the process, to be honest. And once I spoke with the firm and obviously helped them to put together the video and the marketing collateral, I learned a lot in that process. So, yeah, I know a bit more now than I used to, but it didn't really make a difference in terms of starting out, you know, because the company had all the industry knowledge. So I just took from them what I needed and obviously understood how to make that into a service you can offer and do the video and the script for that and then put that all together.
Gotcha. All right, Mike. So let's talk a little bit about why you're selling the site. I mean, there's not a ton of work that goes into this. Why don't you just keep it, grow it, you know, maintain it currently?
Yeah, you know, I mean, that's what I've been doing and that's what I'll keep doing. I'm quite happy to actually hold on to it. The reason I'm putting it up to see what sort of offers come through is just to see if there's someone maybe who's better out there who could take the site and take the service and grow that with a client. For me, like you said, it's pretty passive, so I don't spend a lot of time on it and I'm focusing my energy on a lot of other projects right now. So maybe it's a good time to let it go and, you know, put those funds into some of the other projects that I'm working on.
Gotcha. Tell me what your plan is for the cash. I mean, if you do end up selling this and you get the right price, we work out a deal. What do you do with the cash you get out of it?
Okay, so definitely some of the funds I'll put back into the business. Like I said, I'm working on a new podcast and some other projects, actually some of the lead gen projects. So I use that to fund some of those. And then in terms of, you know, private investments, I'm thinking of buying some property in Chile and some other things. So it's just a few ideas that, you know, I could put the money into.
Gotcha. Okay, so the site was built in February 2011. Tell me a little bit about the trajectory. I mean, the first few weeks, months, I mean, was it making money out of the gate or was it kind of a slow burn getting up to speed?
Yeah, it was interesting. It was pretty much making money out the gate because the concept of putting together a landing page to generate leads, that was there from the start. So we always knew this is the purpose. So we didn't build out like a fancy website. We just had a very simple lead generation page with a squeeze page with a video. And so once I put that together, that's the same video we're using now. And it's just been a case of finding more and more traffic to generate more leads and obviously split testing different things to increase the conversion rate. So it did start small. We started with Google and we did a bit of SEO. I'm actually on a previous website, which is not linked anymore, but we did a bit of SEO on that site. And then we moved over to using Google PPC pay-per-click as well. And that was pretty much our standard for a year or so. And then we sort of tapped into Facebook and we started to move over there to more of our traffic as it's a cheaper source. So it's just kind of grown from there, really.
Now, I know you a bit, Mike. I know that you're a paid traffic guy. So I completely understand why you did the landing page and you basically just funneled it down. I do think, though, that there's a bit of opportunity for, now keep that in place. Don't mess with that at all. But I mean, to do, you know, much more personal branding around it, build out videos, you know, talk about kind of the struggles and the process to bring in some of that organic traffic. But that isn't something you've done up to this point, right?
No, I guess because for the client, it's a very easy to understand the value of a lead, right? It's very tangible value. If you tell them, you know, I'm going to do content marketing for you, I'm going to increase your branding, it's very hard to put a value on that's tangible for them. So if they see a lead coming in, they know, okay, we can close this lead, we can make X amount. So it's just been a much simpler value proposition to run with that. And we've never got to the stage where, you know, we've maxed out all the leads now, so what else can we do? And I think that content marketing, that branding is maybe a phase two exercise in a company once they've already, you know, maxed out their paid traffic.
Gotcha. Okay. So what you have done, we were talking about this before you got on, and you have done some paid traffic via AdWords. That was more expensive. And so eventually you were able to get more margin via Facebook paid traffic. So that's kind of the main source right now. Have you done any other paid traffic? Have you done anything with the site that just didn't work or that wasn't successful?
It's a good question. I mean, we've done a lot of split testing on the landing page itself, so testing different copy, different messages, and obviously, you know, it's just a testing and trial and error process, so we've got a pretty good conversion rate on the website now. In terms of paid traffic, like you said, we started with Google. At the time when we started, actually, there was no other competitors, so we were very new in this space in Singapore. You know, the companies, the other competitors weren't very savvy, they weren't marketing online, so we had a couple of years, good years, you know, there was no one else in Google, and so we were able to get cheap traffic from there, and that's what we did for a long time. And then as we saw more competitors come online, then obviously the cost per click got driven up, and the cost per lead went up. So then I started to look around for other sources, and that's when I got into Facebook. And I wasn't an expert by any means with Facebook at that point, so it was just pretty simple, really, putting together a campaign, because with Facebook you can target, you know, by expats in a particular country, so that's perfect, really targeted audience. And then obviously that increases your click-through rate, which drives down your cost per click, so we're able to get like a really good cost per click on those leads.
Is there anything in particular that surprised you about the site, either really good or really bad, where you built it out and you're like, wow, I didn't think that would work, or I thought that would work and it didn't?
I was kind of surprised how untapped it was at the start. And then even now, in terms of Facebook, Facebook's only recently become more mature as an advertising platform. So I think there's a lot of people not on there yet, which obviously is an opportunity for us. So I was quite surprised just how cheap we could generate the leads for and what the margin was like, you know, because every lead they can close is a $2,000 value sale to them. So I probably could have priced the leads higher if I wanted to. And if I was to approach another company, I would probably price the leads even higher because I know the value of them is even higher. So that's pretty much been my only surprise. Otherwise, it's been pretty consistent because PPC, like you said, it just runs every month. There's a steady search demand, steady demand from people. So it's not a lot I have to do week in, week out to manage the campaign.
Mike, for anyone outside of Singapore that hasn't been or isn't familiar with that, just say that, you know, Singapore is a very high value target, right? So the hotels are expensive. Everything is high priced in Singapore. You know, there's definitely a market there. You're telling me, or at least a couple of years ago, that paid traffic in Singapore was a little weak sauce. Like the marketing wasn't kind of up to par. Is that still the case? Is there still a lot of opportunity for paid traffic in Singapore?
Yeah, it's huge because, okay, there are people advertising in obviously in Singapore with Google AdWords and Facebook, but if you look at their landing pages, they're just horrible, so they're not optimized. And what that means is that their conversion rates aren't very good and they're actually paying more for each lead. So it's very simple for someone like me to come along who has a bit of savvy with online marketing to come, you know, produce a landing page that converts 2, 3, 4 times what my competitors are doing, which allows me to bid 2, 3, 4 times what everyone else is doing and just take over that market. And so that's kind of what we've done here. You know, we've got a you look at the competitors who are advertising in Google, and the websites are not converting at all. You can just tell from the layout they're not very well designed. So there's a massive opportunity there to advertise, because you can outbid your competitors, and obviously you can afford to do that as long as you have good conversion rates on your landing pages.
Australia's been that way for quite a while. I have some Australian buddies that, have followed like SEO tactics, techniques, and paid traffic strategies in the U.S., and then applying that in Australia has just been phenomenal for them, because, Australia's been always a couple of years behind in terms of SEO, local SEO, paid traffic. They've been really successful strategies there. So it seems, I wonder if Singapore is similar. It sounds like it.
Yeah, definitely a few years behind U.S. for sure.
Let's talk about traffic and earnings. So, do you get any organic traffic, or is this all paid social traffic today?
It's all paid social traffic today. We have another site we do some testing on, which is not the primary domain. It's a separate domain. We've done some SEO on that to test, but really it gets like nothing, maybe, 2% of the traffic. So it's really a small source of traffic, and we don't really use that to generate leads. We just use it for testing. So in terms of the leads generated, it's all paid social.
In terms of monetization, you have an agreement with the company to deliver them 1,000 leads a month. Sometimes, paid traffic just isn't perfect like that, where you always get 1,000. So sometimes you're a little over, sometimes you're a little under, and you'll bump your spin to make sure that you hit those targets. We talked about this before the show. Now, we have expenses at $966 a month. How much variance is there? Is it $1,500 some month, $500 the next, or is it $1,200, $850, that kind of thing?
Yeah, there's a very small variance. I would say it's 5 to 10%. Basically, I just look at the numbers every week or so, and I'll see if I need to adjust the bids and the daily budget to increase or decrease the number of leads coming in. But it's a very, very small variance, because we've obviously been doing it a long time, so we kind of have our numbers dialed in on that one.
Are you constantly split testing the ads? I know, paid Facebook traffic, you don't want your audience to get weary with your ads. So how often are you changing the ads on that?
I probably should do it more often. I haven't done an awful lot of it. When I first started out, I did do it for a few months, and then I found a good converting campaign and ad and image, so I just left it at that. I think there's probably still two ads running side by side, but I haven't even looked at it recently, so I'm not actively split testing it. That's probably something I should do if I had more time.
How much traffic is the site getting a month right now?
It's funny, I don't even look at my overall traffic numbers, I just look at the conversion rate. So if you say we're getting 1,000 leads a month, then, assume a 10% conversion rate, which means, you're getting 10,000 traffic visitors a month. I would say that's the rough average, but the conversion rate is between 10 and 15%, so you can adjust the numbers from there.
Great. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about, the opportunities for this. If someone wanted to grow it, you have a set deal with that agency, right, for 1,000 leads. Talk to me a little bit about the agreement. So if I started delivering 1,500, 1,800 leads a month, would they pay for those? What do I do with those leads?
Yes, that's kind of been my challenge also working with that company, is to help them be able to take more leads, because obviously that helps me to increase the revenue monetization. So when we started out, we were doing, 100, 200 leads a month. And obviously in that time, since 3 years ago, we've grown that quite a lot. So maybe 9, 10 times what we were doing originally. And at each stage, it's kind of been that growth pain from the company in terms of, we need to hire more sales rep. We need a better process to close the leads, to follow up the leads. So there's that whole challenge of lead generation, that it's not just how good you are at lead generation, because it's also down to how the company and how many they can close. So it's down to their sales process, their follow-up process. And I've actually done a lot of work with consulting with this client to help them improve, so that they're able to take more leads and as a result. So I'd say that their maximum pain point again now with 1,000 leads, which I'm giving them a few months to deal with and improve their sales processes, and I'm helping them with things like Infusionsoft to set that up, and now obviously that will help them to close more clients as well. So it's just kind of working with them to improve that. If we generate more leads than that, then we have the right to go to other clients and look around to see who else we want to sell to. But I haven't felt the need to do that, because the client's been quite good so far and he's able to adjust with the growth. So
it's interesting. You have to be concerned with their conversion. You can't just say,
absolutely,
okay, I send them a lead, because ultimately if they're not closing those leads, that relationship's going to end. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And so I kind of have to go beyond that simple-minded way of doing it. I'm just doing pay-per-lead, because I wanted a stable client. So I've done a lot of work with them, and that's kind of the benefit of whoever takes over now. They've already got a client who's got more mature process than the other firms. So if you look around what the companies are doing, they don't have any technology, any automation, any kind of follow-up. Whereas, with this company, I've actually worked with them to do all the email follow-ups to the go out to the leads, do the appointment setting, automate all of that, automate the emails, automate the SMS and everything. So the whole sales system is a lot more automated than other clients, and they have a big edge in terms of closing more leads and sales from that.
So let me ask you, so a buyer comes in on this, and how involved in the sales process are they going to need to be with the client? Are they going to have to be, adjusting these sales funnels and helping them figure out their marketing automation?
I don't think it takes a massive amount of day-to-day work. It's kind of, I've done it in phases with them, so now they've got a pretty good platform. At the moment, like I said, we're migrating to Infusionsoft, so it's a learning process for me as well because I haven't used that platform, but it's pretty straightforward. They actually have an Infusionsoft consultant who does the technical stuff, so I'm just moving that over to make it easier for them to manage moving forward. So I'd say it's going to actually be easier for them for a future buyer once they come in, once this platform's on Infusionsoft, because that everything will be integrated. Right now we're using Zapier and a few different applications, so it's not super complicated. I probably could explain to a person in, you know, a couple hours, and then like I said, day-to-day, they're not actually doing much for the client right now. They're using the processes and systems we've set up.
So Zapier is kind of the piece together automated marketing you have, and you're switching over to Infusionsoft. There is a consultant setting it up, but you're working right with that consultant on the lead gen side. Okay, so tell me, I buy the site, right? I buy the site from you this month, next month, and I want to grow it in the next like 6 to 12 months. I want to grow it by 50%, right? At least 50% growth. How would I even go about doing that? Like, what would be your recommendations for me on doing that?
Well, so first of all, I would look at what are the traffic sources you could use. Like I said, we're using Facebook 100% for the traffic at the moment. Definitely, you could tap into Google. You can get some traffic from there, and obviously, that would help you to generate more leads, and then you can start to look for other clients to sell the leads to. So I would definitely use Google, and like I said, YouTube as well. You can find ways of targeting expats in Singapore by the videos they watch on YouTube and the channels they follow. So you could definitely generate leads that way, just like we've done with Facebook. And then in terms of finding other clients, you know, if the existing client, my current client, can't handle the extra leads, you would look to other clients, and you would just see who your competitors are. So you can go into google.com.sg, the Singapore Google, you can type in some of the keywords like Singapore PR application, you can see the competitors who are also advertising for these type of services, and you can just approach them and say, hey, look, what's your cost per lead right now? It's probably going to be double or triple what they could buy from me. And so if you give them some leads and they test it out, you just do the same thing I did with my client, basically, and that's how I would do it.
All right, Mike. So let's talk a little bit about the risks. I mean, one of the things I see is that, I mean, you have one client paying you, right? Now, you know, if they were to back down, like, does my exclusivity go away? So let's say they cut their budget in half. Could I go to other clients? And how many other clients are there that would be willing to buy these types of leads?
Sure, that's a good question. So yeah, right now we're working just with one client because they've been able to always scale to the growth and take all the leads, so we haven't had to look for other clients. We do have that clause in the contract to say if they don't want to buy the leads, we have the right to sell them anywhere else. So if one month they come and say, hey, we only want 500 leads, it's never happened, but if they do that, then we can go and we can look for other firms to sell to. In terms of how many other firms there are, like I said, I would guess around 5 or 6 based on the people advertising in Google. So there's maybe 5 or 6 other firms offering the same, you know, PR managed application service in Singapore, and I would just approach them and I would try and help them measure their cost per lead currently to prove there's a good ROI by working with us instead.
You probably don't have those contacts today, but would you be willing to share those, you know, that list of potential competitors with the buyer?
Yeah, I'm happy to share that with a serious buyer. It's not private information. You can find it on Google anyway, so yeah, no issue.
Great. Okay, and the other thing I'm worried about is that, you know, it's solely based on Facebook, and that's one of the things that I think the new buyer should look to diversify away from. So, you know, if there are any problems with Facebook or, you know, too many other competitors getting into the Facebook space and make it too expensive, at least you have alternative traffic strategies that are working. I know that you moved away from AdWords because it was, you know, just not as good a margin, but I think, you know, looking for other tactics and strategies they can use for that traffic might be interesting.
Yeah, I would definitely say it's not good to have all your eggs in one basket, but, you know, with Google, the cost is higher, but if, you know, you're still making good margin on the absolute revenue, then why not expand if you have other clients to sell those leads to? So I would definitely go back into Google and also look at YouTube for diversification. I like PPC just because it's more consistent than SEO, so I wouldn't really diversify into SEO until I've done, you know, all the paid traffic channels out there. So that would be my first stop.
How likely or how close are you to burning out the current Facebook audiences that you currently have? Are they just getting bombarded with your ads or your competitors' ads, or is it enough to continually, you know, keep marketing to month after month?
So yeah, it's a good question. So I looked at the, in terms of the audience reach that Facebook estimates, you know, your ad is serving out to, and then how many people were actually getting the ad served out to. So, and also the click-through rate, because that's a good indication of how much you're wearing out your audience. So definitely when we started, we had a higher click-through rate. Right now it's about 4.5% click-through rate, which is still very good for Facebook, and that's been pretty consistent now for the last few months. So I've just kept it at the daily budget that we're on right now to ensure that we don't kind of burn through our audience faster, and I think it's pretty consistent because the numbers stayed the same. So anyone could come and look at the campaign, they would see the same thing, that, you know, the click-through rate's been very consistent, and I've just left it there. I don't know the absolute limit in terms of what the reach would be. I haven't really explored that.
Mike, what do you consider the risks on this business? Like, what keeps you up at night, or which piece of the business are you like, ooh, I'm not so hot on that, it's working, but I don't like that piece of it?
It's a pretty hands-off business right now, so I don't really worry about it too much. When I started out, my worry was obviously the client, how many leads they could close, how much they could sell. And so I've done a lot of work, like I said, consulting with them to improve their sales process and follow-up process. Now that's pretty okay. Obviously, they're still a small company, so they might have turnover in their sales staff. A new guy comes through, maybe they have a month or two where they're not able to close as much. So there's always that risk. You do lead generation for any company, you have that risk. But that's never really materialized into any issue. So the leads have been bought every month for 3 years, and the sales statistics are there to show that. So it's been pretty consistent and pretty steady. Definitely the competitors we had in Google that worried me for a while until we found Facebook. So I think it's just a matter of adapting and staying ahead of the curve. And again, like I said, I look at the competitors. Their websites are pretty horrible for conversion. So I'm really not too worried about them longer term in terms of staying dominant in this niche.
So Mike, this isn't a question about risk, but I am curious, and I think we were discussing it briefly, that have you done any deeper kind of analysis of the leads? Have you tried to like segment them out or like get more information out of them to see if you can better qualify them for the client? Or is it just straight up, here's a name, phone number, and email?
Yeah, it's a good question. So actually, we do qualify them quite heavily. We collect not just their contact information, but their details like their basic salary, how long they've been in Singapore, what work visa they're on, have they applied for PR before, have they been rejected? So all those kind of fields is in the sign-up form when they claim a free consultation. And then based on that data, we can kind of assess the value of that lead. And in terms of what's a better quality lead, obviously the higher salary leads are potentially easier to get PR for, so my client prefers to work with those. But we pretty much have a flat rate per lead just because that's the way we've always done it. I have adjusted the pricing slightly since we started. So because they're buying more leads from me now, you know, they're getting a slight discount on the volume that they're buying. They're buying 1,000 leads a month, so I've given them a slight discount. And I also don't charge them for the very low bracket of leads, which is the people signing up that have a salary below $2,500 Singapore dollars a month, because there's very little my client could do for those. So I'm not charging for those, but even without, you know, we're still making a very good margin, like you can see. So that's kind of how we qualify and help the client value those leads.
Gotcha. God, I'd hate to make less than $2,500 Singapore dollars a month to live in Singapore.
It's not funny. Yeah.
That's rough, man.
It's tough life.
That's an expensive city. I go there and I feel like I'm just throwing my money around. Let's talk a little bit about the work required for you. So I know that you've done a lot with the client to kind of clean up their SOPs and their funnels and kind of get that working well. What do you do on the site right now, or what do you do for the business right now in terms of maintenance?
Like I said, it's actually very little right now. I'm traveling, so I'm not actually in Singapore. When I'm in Singapore, I'll meet with them sometimes, you know, sit down just to chat with their salespeople, see what challenges they're having, how we can automate the next level of, you know, marketing and sales for them. But when I'm traveling and they today, there's actually no real maintenance or requirement for me to sit down with them. I've offered them a weekly call, which they haven't really taken me up on. So there's actually none of my time going to managing the campaign right now because everything is automated. So you set up the campaign, the leads come in, they go out automatically via SMS and email to the client. It all goes into a spreadsheet. I can see how many leads have been generated, and I just bill them, you know, in advance each month. So even the billing is automated with PayPal subscriptions. So there's not a lot of time and effort I put in on a daily basis to this project.
I like the fact that you have them on subscription. I think that's really nice and helpful. If someone were to buy the site and if they were going to hit the ground running and really just, you know, slide into this role and just own it, what kind of skills do you think they would have? Like, what would be just the perfect buyer for this?
I think someone with an understanding of sales and marketing who's maybe been in a sales role or had some role in the company doing sales and marketing would obviously help just to understand the typical challenges of, you know, following up with inbound marketing and leads that come in online. Definitely one of the challenges my client had was, you know, they just didn't follow up in time. If you look at some of the studies out there, you've got to follow up a lead within 5-10 minutes. Otherwise, the conversion rate drops off and then they'll come back to you and say, oh, the lead was crap. So just having an understanding of the basic, you know, best practices for sales and marketing will definitely give you an edge. But I've done a lot of that work anyway, so it's not like you need to come in and improve things massively. It would just be a good thing to have. And then obviously some paid traffic experience as well to look at the numbers, be able to interpret them, see what it means. If you've never used Facebook pay-per-click, it may take you a few days, you know, to get your head around it, but it's not a super complex platform. And I'd be happy to handhold the buyer as well and kind of show them how to set everything up and be around for a few months after the sale to, you know, help them if they have any issues. So it's not like a super niche skill set they need to have, really.
So if someone came into this and they were a sales funnel, sales and marketing guru, and they had, you know, amazing paid traffic experience, that'd be an amazing fit. Now, if they have a bit of experience in those areas, that would work as well. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And like I said, anything like that, I could help bridge the gap in terms of learning gaps they have. But I'm not an expert by any means. It's not like I came in with all this knowledge. It's just something I've learned along the way. And so I'm happy to show them what I've learned.
So let's talk about some additional information or some additional questions. One of the things I know that depositors have asked about, you know, I'd be worried about if I were buying this. So I want to make sure that you're not going to compete with me. If you go out the next day and, you know, start creating the same exact funnel and start going for the competitors, that would be problematic for me. Are you willing to sign a non-compete here to limit my new competitor from popping up the day after I purchase this?
Yeah, absolutely. That's no issue.
And then you're not planning on being in this space anymore from this point forward, right?
No. I'm looking into doing something similar maybe in Australia and other markets as well. I would say that's a big option for growth. But in Singapore, absolutely, you know, I've done everything I want to do. So I've got no interest moving forward in that.
Great. So how much support are you willing to offer buyers? If someone wants to come in and they want to understand kind of what you set up for the client, they're going to need some introductions, that kind of thing. How much support are you willing to offer?
Yeah, I mean, I'd definitely introduce the clients to them, you know, on a few calls if that's what it takes, and then maybe weekly calls as well, you know, come on and make sure they're on board and they've got everything running, and obviously email support for a month or two. I'd be happy to offer that. It's, like I said, it's pretty passive, so there's not that much work actively day to day to manage it. So I don't think it would take very long to hand over the project.
How familiar is the client with what you're doing? Do they know you're selling? Like, would they be comfortable with that?
Yeah, I told them already that I'm looking to see if there's someone else who can take it on. Probably I would introduce, you know, any buyer as a partner and say this guy's joining, you know, as a partner basis, and then transfer over that way to make it less a drastic transition for them in terms of perception. But they've said they have no issue as long as they keep getting the leads and the service works the same way it's working today, then they won't have an issue. So
great.
Yeah, they're fine with it.
And the client would have no problem signing a new contract with the buyer so they can get that up and running and have it with the contract signed with a new company, right?
Yeah, no issues.
Great. Okay. And then are you open to a split or earnout? Some situations, you know, where there's like heavy training required, sometimes we do 70% up front and 30% after 30 days or 60 days after the training is complete. In this situation, I think it might be likely that someone's going to want to do an earnout because, you know, of the risk that's associated with the, you know, client canceling, right? So they're going to want to put some of that in an earnout. How open are you to that?
Yeah, I'd have to look at the numbers, but I think that's fine. You know, a 30, 60-day period of transition is normal, and so I understand that concern. So, yeah, I'll be open to that.
So, yeah, 100% cash up front is clearly the best option for you, and then
you're
willing to look at the other options. Yeah, of course. All right, man, so let's do a quick wrap-up. I mean, we're talking about a lead generation site in the legal services niche. It's for Singapore residence applications. It was built in February 2011. Monetization is lead generation, and that's directly with the client, and you have a contract in place with the client to continue to provide those leads, $1,000 a month. The net profit on the site is currently $5,267.26. What's your best pitch to someone who's listening to this interview on why they should buy this site, on why this might be a good fit for them?
I think that most of the hard work's been done here, so pretty much day-to-day everything's automated. There's not a lot of work. You know, I spend very little time on this site, and so it doesn't costing much to run it. So just in terms of that, it's a great asset to have because it doesn't take up much of your time. And if you're a business entrepreneur, you're growing your business, you don't want to spend all your day on a single project or a single campaign. You just want a cash flow asset that can run and sustain itself. And that's pretty much what this is doing. So like I said, I'm really not desperate to sell this. Unless I get really good offers, I'll just keep, because I'm quite happy with how it's working for me so far.
Cool, Mike. If anyone is interested in this, I think there's some opportunity too if you want to diversify away from strictly organic traffic. I mean, this is definitely a paid traffic play. It might help to diversify your portfolio. There's a social aspect to it. And if you wanted to, I think you could take the content marketing approach with this. You know, that may be kind of, you know, as you mentioned, the phase two thing. So anyway, Mike, thanks so much for doing this. If you're on YouTube watching this or elsewhere, you can click the link in the notes and it'll take you over to the listing so you can review this listing. If you're on the listing itself, you look up on the top right-hand corner and you can pay the deposit. That will give you access to everything, including Facebook information, including analytics, including the contract with the supplier. And we'll get you everything you need to have to perform due diligence and make sure that this purchase is the right one.